Morris. Again, that's not making any difference. I'm sorry, we're coming tonight. Do we have any apologies, councillors?
Chair, I have apologies from councillor Bruce Rhys-Jones, Bruce Berry, Andrew Hossey, Joyce Pilgrim, and councillor Berry here is a good substitute member this evening.
Okay, thank you. Let's go to conduct declarations of interest in party. Anyone got any declarations of interest? No webs enforced tonight?
Yes.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thank you.
I don't have webs.
Speak yourself.
Right, okay, then before we move on to the minutes, I've just got something I want to read out with regards to local plaque. So members will be aware that on Friday last week we received a letter which stated that the Secretary of State was reminded to intervene in our local plan. Since Friday, our officers have been in dialogue with the Chief Planner and the Civil Service Leader. There are ongoing discussions with the ECLG planners ahead of a likely meeting in London between Wirral Council and their Chief Planner. The main issue appears to be the timetable to complete the local plan and the desire by the Secretary of State for that completion to be speeded up. Once the meeting between the Council and the Chief Planner has taken place, we will undertake the following. One, ensure the appropriate resources and robust governance is in place. And two, rate jointly Wirral Council, DCLG, Civil Service, the Secretary of State, with a clear view on what we need to do to meet the DCLG requirements and expectations. It's important that all members are aware that the government have not said they are intervening in our plan. They have said they are minded to get involved, and we will continue to work closely with the civil servants to agree a timetable and approach to deliver the local plan for the appropriate time and meeting with residents' needs. This is a standard item that has been pulled off the agenda of the PERDA, but I have requested that an update report to be brought back to the first committee in the new council year to give us an update with regards to that.
Obviously, it's such an important issue. Obviously, I understand the reasons why it's important now, but if it's a timeliness issue, when's the first committee meeting in the new sort of year? Does it not need to be before then that we actually discuss this?
It's in June.
It might be that we need to bring something for central.
That would depend on what takes place between the government and the authority.
Clearly, that's a side of these meetings. An issue of this involved would be discussed with Cabinet as well, so it would be.
Okay, thanks very much.
That's a good job, sir.
Yeah, that's what I did.
Yes.
So, on to item two, the minutes.
Hello, Chair.
Thanks, Chair. The next item. Okay, thank you. On to item three, the financial monitoring report. Mark Gordon is going to give us a presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I drew the short straw today. Normally, people already would attend this meeting. He's our annual leader. He asked if I could deputise for him, which I said I would. And then it was only recently said that actually, we should be able to report for you on the conference presentation. I've pulled together some slides, so hopefully this will aid your understanding of the report that we've got in front of you. So as context, before we start with the environment budget, it's just to put in the context of the entire council budget. So in 17-18, we have a net budget of £267 million, of which environment accounts for £69 million, about 25%. The council as a whole, as of quarter three, is forecasting an underspending of £1.3 million. Obviously, that's a simple statement. It masks a complex financial landscape of everything. Obviously, we know this issue with the children and adults in demand and pressures. Increased children, including blood death for children, and increasing social requirements. So obviously, and the environment element of that is actually forecasting currently at £1 million. And I'll go through that so we can start in more detail on that. The environment budget is made up of budgets within three of the cabinet portfolio areas: environment, housing, community safety, and localism and engagement. And you can see the budgets there. And the overspend in the environment area is £981,000 for the forecast overspending this year. The bulk of which falls within the environment portfolio. Break that down into further detail for you. These are the services that sit within Council of Rightmore's environment portfolio. As you can see, there's a number of services, all with varying variances against their budget. But the three main areas of variance in this financial year are waste and environments, sport and recreation, and cultural services. So I'll concentrate on that, giving an explanation for those who agree upon that. Wasted environments at the start of this financial year had an approved saving of £500,000 that we found in contract deficiencies. Unfortunately, negotiations with our waste environment, we've been unable to find the full amount of that contract deficiency. We found smaller amounts, which has brought the amount down to £392,000. Looks like we've been unable to. Continue to work with our department to find further efficiency. It's a similar story with sports and recreation. At the start of the year, group savings of £1 million were approved for a range of projects across a number of leisure centres. So there's been problems with some savings areas such as Woodchurch. The consultation was staff, but the saving there was longer and wider than we anticipated. As a consequence, we had to shortfall and saving of about £200,000. There's issues at Lee Sales Recreation at the moment. There's a project there for a football pitch at the back. Unfortunately, there's architectural issues and drainage issues that we've had in bringing that scheme to fruition, which is again delaying the saving. And then it's short of about £50,000. So there's a few projects that are all accumulated to $300,000 that we will need to overspend this budget. And the other one I've highlighted there is cultural services. That's the theatre and museums. And the Floral has historically struggled to meet its expenditure from its income. And again, there's an issue still there, it's a historic issue, and each year we get a little bit closer to achieving the budget target. But again, it's probably about 70,000. So as you can see, the main overspend for the whole of this environment theme is within the environment portfolio there at 1.2 million. I'll just quickly go through the other portfolio areas. Housing and community safety. Again, a number of services with lots of variances, lots of small variances. But just to highlight two, the registration and coroner and assessment. There's an overspend on the registration and coroner, and this is a service that went to be a shared service across Merseyside a couple of years ago, and it was hoped that there would be savings off the back of it. There were some, but obviously it's not managing to meet the full budget that we were anticipating at the time. And that's an overspend of £229 forecast for this year. Obviously that's offset with numerous underspends, one of which is the assessment section there. We have the team that deals with housing benefits, and we've had a number of vacancies within that area this year that's helped generate some underspend. Overall, that's that portfolio comes to £400,000 in underspend. Moving on to the localism and engagement portfolio, two main areas there. The overspend in this area is mainly from the Commons Marketing Press and PR, which had advertising within the target this year, but it is not quite managed to meet, and that's the main reason for that. to add together those three portfolios and all the services within them into about a million pound then spent for this environment thing, against the budget system.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Moving on to next year.
Can I just ask a question? It's hard to see, sorry, less than me, it's hard to see the minuses. How does a constituency committee get on here? Because you've got it as a minus, therefore in minus, it's not met the target. Does that mean it's overspent? Because you can't imagine how you can do things.
Sorry, my experience is an underspend in this instance. Sorry, that's minus 53, that's an underspend against the budget of 53,000 pounds.
So they have spent all their money?
That's correct.
Will that be the money that's been given that hasn't been put into projects yet? Is that the sort of money you're talking about?
It could be, I don't know the exact answer, but yes, it's that. Things like the growth company and developments in the area that should bring in additional income. We've got the income for public conveniences, for charging for those on that. Litter enforcement, the litter enforcement contract is due for renewal this year. We're hoping to get some efficiencies and some innovative actions from that. Garden waste marketing, we're hoping to increase the uses of garden waste by 7,500, which should be an extra income. The levies come in, the Merseyside waste levy has come in at a much reduced level than we were anticipating, so that statement should be achieved. And again, there's a few other smaller ones there within housing, some restrictions for public communications. We'll all add up to savings next year, hopefully at the meeting of 1,000 pounds. Just to run through the capital programs, the other area of marketing. Capital programme 5.3, £5.4 million this financial year, 2017-18. At the time of quarter three, the spend was £2.6 million on all those various capital projects. I won't go through each of them, just to pick out a few. You can see there, as Lisa Leisure said, you can see the plan to spend £100,000, reduce the issues of trains, which we've been able to, and obviously it's had a knock-on effect into the government budget. And then, West Berry flood alleviation is on there, also up 100,000. That's the preliminary works for a much bigger scheme that will take place over the next few years. Spend is obviously, by the end of the financial year, should be a lot closer to that 5.3. And then just to finish off with the capital programme and schemes that are in for next year, this is what was approved last month at Council. Further money is the beach cleaning and buildings in parks and put them there. Obviously the upgrade for public toilets that will help generate the income that we hope from that project. And then some monies to refurbish buildings in our gallery to make sure it's up to date and it's fully ready to look after the works of art. That was the sort of whistle stop tour through the finances. I hope that's okay. I just want to really brush them if I can.
Just two things. A £17,000 shortfall. This has obviously been ongoing since we built. What's been done to make that become self-sufficient?
Question for the
business,
but obviously every year. Thank you. trust the staff in such a way that it's efficient and effective and to continue going with the it is an ongoing project.
There's such a time where it's going to become so simple.
This is a time where it means it's a budget target. Self-sufficient is a different target.
And the other question that I've got is on the housing ombudsman. You said that it's an underspend because of staff that haven't been replaced yet. What's the reason for that not being replaced?
I don't know exactly so about that. It's very busy, but I thought it was going to have to go away.
So that's on the housing benefit?
Oh, the assessments, yes.
Yeah, the assessments. So, okay. I'm just conscious that at the time we've got a lot of people with those equipment that we're going to need those staff to assist with the placements. So we raise the concern that we're not replacing the staff. Okay. Any questions? Okay, I'll take Chris.
First time I've got any mic.
Take it away.
I'm not quite sure if this is right. The previous slide we've got aid adaptation and the M2 figures. The slide previous about supporting people, are those connected? So is that part of the minus 51 the DMG stuff? Because my question is going to be, how is that calculated when the adaptations for the DFG grant have been capped at 30k for the last 10 years and not moved? It's increasing their value, so you're not going to get as much done for that amount of money. It seems that we've still got the same amount of work to be done. How does that look?
So the DFGs that you refer to is a capital scheme where we have capital money available to help people.
Just a declaration of interest, Chair, which you mentioned universal credits. I'm employed by the Department for Work and Pensions for now.
Yeah. take Brian out.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Yeah, going back to the point about the registration and parliament, I think you said that we're not delivering the savings that we hope to do. Is this now within the whole of the Liverpool City region? Is this just a temporary thing so this new system gets in and I might start delivering savings in the near future?
That's the hope, but I would have to get back to you. It's not that's the hope.
Alright, thank you.
From Adam, Tony, and Steve.
Thanks, Chair. Just a couple of questions. The first one was about the overspend related to the planned savings on the waste contract. And when we had the workshop, and we came out that the savings were based on an office of prediction before they'd actually spoken to the contractor, they could be able to achieve that saving. Is that then going to stay there for future years that potentially that saving won't be that ongoing saving? Are we getting on with that? Is there a bit more information about where we're up to with that? And then the second question is just on the localism engagement. Is that shortfall on advertising income, is that related to the review? Because the review hasn't achieved its targets for advertising. So two questions.
Thank you.
For you, Chair, I'll take the first one. I fronted up the winter top sheet. Just by way of background, so just recapping on some of the discussion we've had here, we did preliminary planning around potential savings through the BIFA contract, and the premise was that we deliver efficiency savings without changing standards of frontline service delivery. It's fair to say that we did preliminary work as officers based on discussions that we have had over time with the contractor. But then once the budget option, once that was accepted and we got into that detailed planning stage, it then became apparent that those level of savings weren't going to be achievable when we got into that detailed planning with the contractor. One of the things that will have likely been a factor at the time, obviously I can't comment in detail on BIFA's commercial views and positions as a company, but you may recall that around about that time they did float on the stock exchange and become a public company. And it is fair to say that after that took place, BIFA's management approach and the way they did business has obviously changed on a variety of fronts, and they obviously have to report it to shareholders. So we have seen, it's fair to say, an evolution in management views and working with BIFA since the float. So I think that was the answer to the first one, and the second one.
Sorry, can you just add that? Is that going to be an issue for future years, because you haven't got that saving?
Yeah, so well, I think what Nicky Butterworth is leading on the work now to find compensatory savings. What I do know is that she is looking at entirely new areas and ideas and working with BIFA around where we might find savings. So obviously the float are now. Their management approach has changed, but Nicky and the team, we do know who we're dealing with, we know how things have evolved, and they're coming up with lots of really new and exciting ideas to find that saving. And we'll be known as on Nicky to come forward with those ideas as we start to develop.
Thank you.
I think the communication press and PR, the 200,000 is a shortfall in income target. They set themselves ambitious income targets for this financial year, and they've unfortunately not quite met those income targets. It's not an area I deal with. I can go back and find, I'm sure, that part of the issue will be across a wide range of their advertising, which mentioned.
Thank you.
Yes, thanks, Chair. Just following up on sports and recreation, and you mentioned that the consultation about operation changes at Woodchurch Leisure Centre, and I think you said that it's going to be an overspend of about 100,000.
The 200,
about that. Can I just, just coincidental this really, I think last Friday, was it Friday? Last Friday. resident of Woodchurch phoned me up, let's call her Mrs. H, and she had just come out of hospital, and she, a couple of days later, went down to the leisure centre because she wanted to take up swimming to try and, you know, get back, sort of get her health from that. When she was there, she was she wanted to do a monthly booking and wanted to pay by cash her car. But that was turned down because the only method of payment apparently is direct debit. Now, she was really taken aback by that and said, you know, she didn't want to commit herself to a direct debit because of financial or her family, but she was willing to pay cash there for 4 weeks or pay by car. Is that factual? I didn't think it would be true.
I'm not aware of that. I assume that I have taken the debit and check that for you and get back to
the institution. I mean, I can give you the details of the lady as well. I was on the phone for quite a long time and said, I do not think that would be possible. But she said the staff would not take her cash or would not take her card for the 4 week booking. Yeah, well, I'm just worried about if there's an overspend in that.
So the overspend with Woodchurch, it was a delay in the saving
thing. I realise that, yes.
They expect that to come in on top of the next financial year. The consultation will go through brilliantly at the end of it. That should be operational.
And so the operation that you're looking at is looking at reconfiguring staff, is that what you're looking at?
Yes, that's
correct. Okay, thank
you.
Okay,
Tony, Mark.
Thank you. I'm going to give you the details of the lady at the end, so we can contact her.
Thank you. Steve?
Yeah, well, what appears to me is that we see this report, but this is only quarter three, so we've already set the budget for next year, and effectively, we're looking in hindsight saying, oh, wish we'd have done something about it. So my proposal is, Chair, to actually use this report in time for next year. So if there are issues that we need to come up, I think you mentioned before, constantly made us meet certain targets. I know a number of our members have got some concerns about, are we collecting in the money we should? And that story about Woodchurch, if we may pay simpler, we might get more money. So my view would be that we don't sort of sit idly by and wait for this overspend next year. We actually begin the year with, and there's been a number, not your fault by the way, there's been a number of questions that have been made that we haven't been able to get the answers to. But if the officers were to go away and think about a programme next year where we could analyse in a bit more depth some of these continual overspends, that we could actually be proactive about it and have some ideas. A number of our members have some good ideas about how we get more money in. I was at the floor on Sunday night, it was cramped. Anyone remember Heat Wave?
Oh, yeah. Groovy
nights? Yeah, no. So I went to see them. The place it was hard to envisage how something as popular as that, as good a venue as that, isn't sort of saying. Yeah, so I'm just saying members don't want to sit idle and buy and wait for another overspend next year, or we want to actually get involved early on in the year. So if through your guidance, presume it'd be chair next year, but your guidance and the office, if we could put a programme aware together for us where we can have a little bit of an in-depth analysis on income generation, stopping the gates of overspend, we can actually sort of be part of the cure rather than simply wait for the results every year. So that's just my suggestion.
Okay. That's something that the officers can get on the work program agenda, and is the committee happy for that?
Yeah.
Agreed. I've got Tony Jones, and then I'll take Chris.
Mine's just on the back of what Steve just said, Chair, in so much as if we had more information available, for argument's sake, a business plan on the floor, I think that would be a relevant document that the committee would be interested in viewing. And I'd like to think that we can start, as Steve said, taking a more proactive part in making sure that these other spends don't occur.
Chris?
Thanks, Chair. I haven't mentioned the word of hoops, sorry guys.
part and parcel of these facts and figures, though, I'm with you guys, we don't understand what they are. I would like to see, and I've asked for this, and I can't apparently get this information, but I'd like to see how much of that spending on Willowview advertising was cross-charging within Willowview Council itself, and how much of the advertising came from outside of Willowview, and how much of that was Willowview cross-charging, because having an understanding of where we are, then maybe we can look at, if it's going to carry on, looking at maybe how we advertise it, or what advertising we chase outside of Willowview Council. So, can we get those figures?
Mr. Chair, as part of that programme, if we're saying expected income is down to £1,000 and that's had an effect on the end of the year spend, nothing's safe, everything's off the grounds. But I'm surprised we may maybe not get an outside advertising, because every time all I hear from the opposition about the view is negativity, negativity. So I'm not just an outsider thinking about where should I advertise you.
Because it is a live issue, and I accept what Steve's saying, but I accept what everybody else is saying. We have to look at what the general view of the people of Wirral is as well. And we have to be able to answer, yes, it is making money, or no, it isn't making money. Yes, it is keeping people informed, or no, it isn't keeping people informed. Because that is a sensible and fair thing to do. And that's why I think we need somebody like Kevin here to talk to us with actual figures, not this is what I'd like to do if I had my way, but actually what is going on and how it's being done. And I would request that we have that as soon as possible, please.
Thank you.
Just to support what Christina's saying on that quite clearly, because all those questions that we are now asking again, they were all asked when we actually called it in, before it actually even went live. And the promise was then that clearly we wouldn't be advertising in the local press, which we thought was absolutely abhorrent, because we heard from a witness at the Cave that that could cost up to 90 full-paid jobs. It would be very interesting to know now, because the rural users clearly got to the wall for whatever reason or other. And we were promised that all advertising would be in the rural view, and therefore we wouldn't be going outside. And quite rightly so, as Councillor Carubia says now, we don't seem to have any adverts at all from anybody from the outside in rural view. I hope it collapses, to be quite honest, but that's another issue, but I do have to collapse it, because clearly it's taken advertisements, as we predicted, away from the free press, and that can only be bad. And now we seem to be doubling up because not only are we getting narrowers in the world view, we are now paying for, you know, coloured gloss, well, not glossy, but coloured wraparounds now from the leader of the council, which seems to be just a complete propaganda about how well he thinks rural is now and how well he thinks rural will be in the future. So I would quite agree. I think it's about time now that we did have Kevin McCann back. We asked him the questions that we posed to him at the call-in, which must be a couple of years ago now. And I understand that the Wirral View has already cost us £250,000, you know, £250,000 of public money, and it's projected to spend another £140,000 this coming year. And I would just like to, obviously, I will deputise on that committee if I'm not a full member next year, but I'd like to ask Kevin just how much is this going to cost the people of Wirral. And also, could he also tell us that what percentage of the population it is reaching, because there are numerous reports from people who say they don't get it, they don't necessarily want it, but if we were told at just this exception that everybody would get it, because that was the problem with the free press. So clearly, I support what you're saying for a full report back with the relevant officer to answer those questions.
Yeah, I'm going to sit down. I think I've exhausted this. We're going to invite Ken McCallum to present to us at the next committee meeting.
Can I just say that we have been asked by on a number of occasions to give other examples of how we can get Wirral View out. And I think it's beholden on us, if we're asking Kevin to come, to have some ideas. Because certainly the standard which I get at Sainsbury's and Neston is has a wide readership. So there are other ways, and I think it's beheld on top of this committee, not just to be criticising. We want to know the facts, then we can go away and say, right, this is how we feel this could be done better, or we are satisfied. I'm not convinced that Kevin is going to come here and we're going to go for the jugular. I think that it is getting better, and the distribution, but I want to know all the facts, because we can all say we can polarise on this. As much as we like, I want the facts before I polarise.
Okay.
And I polarise over to you.
So we'll agree that we're going to invite Kevin to present to us
Not greatest respect, you know. These leader and deputy of the Conservative Party hijacked that on committee. It's been hijacked for one day. Well, we've seen their advertising with the Globe. We know their opinion.
Well, we advertise them like sticker readers.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. The members have heard the report with the comments. Item 4. Report of the law plan for Mr. Marshall.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. So as members will be aware, we come here regularly with updates on performance. This is the usual quarter three report to the end of December. In the usual way, all of the detail is on the council's website in terms of pledges, indicators, supporting measures, and then even the action plans that sit below that. But in your report, in Appendix 1, we've got a summary. So for each pledge, we have progress against the indicators and those supporting measures and quarter three. Very happy to take any questions in the usual way.
Any questions? Adam and Leslie are checking, and we start
scrutinising.
We're scrutinising.
Adam.
You have the lights on. Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to draw attention to the recycling reduction that's mentioned in the report. I just firstly, given the trash we used recently, I've got a good report. It's not like what's pulling the food waste, which for some reason seems to be for that as a cost rather than a savings option. But I don't understand that. So the idea was that food waste would reduce landfill charges and it would be ultimately a saving, not just to the effort and then to spend. So I'm just wondering what's plan B for that, and also how are we going to increase recycling rates? Obviously it says there's a trend across the Northwest, but that's not an excuse, that's just a
Okay, thank you, Chair. So, so across the country, so it's not just a rural local trend, but it's a national trend that over the past few years local authorities have done well in terms of boosting recycling rates, but now those rates are starting to flatline in all areas. So that's an issue for us all, and there's a whole variety of reasons for that. In the coming year, for the pledge for next year and the detailed action plan we're working up, we're fleshing out a whole series of actions and interventions, as our cabinet members talked about, to drive recycling rates. So one of the key things that we need to do is we've got a good recycling system and a scheme out there at the moment with the grey and the green bins supported by the garden waste. But even now we know that we have issues around the buy-in and our residents all using that. Sometimes there are issues around residents actually knowing what does and doesn't go into the recycling bin, etc. So there really is something like, even with the scheme that we've got, we think that there's still a long way to go in terms of sweating that existing system, the one phase that we could use. So that's going to be at the heart of the programme for next year, very much building on that existing system. And working with local residents and communities, building on some recent publicity around blue planet and single-use plastics and that whole agenda. We're seeing some strong messages coming out from central government around future recycling targets and plans, lots of coverage in the TV and press. So at a local level, we're looking at really building on that head of steam in the coming year, really. So that's the overall plan.
My question was on the same subject that Adam just asked about. Can I just ask, are the rates lower in specific areas of the world? And are we targeting those more harder to try to get them? Because that was almost how it was at the inception of the scheme. I mean, I think the green bin and the grey bin is a fantastic system, and long may it continue as far as I'm concerned. But also as well, what is really worrying is the tonnage which the lots of recyclables that goes to landfill, because that was the whole mantra that we had when we brought in the present system about the cost particularly, and also the restrictions of the tonnage that we were going to be allowed to actually send to landfill. So really, I suppose my question is, the areas really, are they still the same areas
were pushed forward on recycling as they were when the system was brought in, and how we were going to do that? Thank you. One of the positives is that working with our partner contractor, BIFA, we're building up very detailed intelligence down to neighbourhood, but down to individual street level, particularly around levels of participation. Particular streets, are they actually putting the bins out at all, etc. So one of the key things for the coming year is, based on that very detailed intelligence, actually getting people out there on the ground from the council, if they're actually not